of Commerce, and the topic chosen for today's discussion is the RERA Act, the dawn of a whole new era in the real estate sector. Mr. Mohammed Ashfaq is with SJCC for more than 5 years now, and he specializes in teaching various commerce and management subjects. He has also been simultaneously coordinating postgraduate diploma courses at SJCC. He is also a principal investigator in UGC-sponsored minor research project titled Women Empowerment Through Self-Help Groups, a study in Kolar district, Karnataka state. I extend a very warm welcome to Mr. Mohammed Ashfaq as our moderator for the discussion today. Our panel members, Amina Asim from 2BCOM B, Anjali Savani from 2BCOM E, Sarita Ravindwan from 2BCOM E, Kevin Anjali Kavito from 2BCOM E, Karan Kapil Singh from 3BCOM E, Anushree Patra from 3BCOM A, and Akshat S. Kincha from 3BCOM A. Now, I would like to hand over the proceedings to Mr. Mohammed Ashfaq.
Good afternoon, one and all present here. Today's session, it's going to be discussion on real estate regulatory authority, which is a new topic and a new regulator in the scenario. Now, today we are going to have the discussion in this order. Firstly, we will have all the members presenting, each one on a given topic, post which we will have a 15 minutes discussion, and after that we will keep the floor open for the audience and have an open house discussion. So over to Kevin.
Good afternoon to one and all present here today. So as we all know, the real estate sector has provided a lot of investment for us as commoners, and we have seen a lot of transformation over the years. But coming to the question today, what is RERA and why the need for RERA? Before that, I would like to point out four main points to it. So firstly, it was noticed that in the last decade, we weren't doing really well as our inventory had fallen, and because of this, sales decreased and therefore the liquidity of the developers decreased. Secondly, in 2007, it was estimated that out of 5,88,000 crore rupees, only 5,000 crore rupees consisted of the organized market. That means that out of that, 5,83,000 crore rupees was consisted of the unorganized market, and this led to unregulated business practices. Third, apart from being just an investment sector, I think all of us would agree to it that, you know, it's the best possible way to turn the black money into white. And this is something that we have been trying to eradicate for many years. Lastly, there was a downward side in the buyer's attitude, and this was simply because projects were not completed on time or the amenities were not delivered to them. So, what is RERA and what are the objectives of it? To put it in simple terms, RERA, or the Real Estate Regulation Authority Bill, was introduced in March 2013 and finally got effective from May 2016. Its objectives is to protect the interest of the buyer and at the same time ensure timely delivery of projects.
So this RERA is established to safeguard the customers who majority of the customers felt that in the previous years that they felt cheated, and then the developers are taking them for a ride by taking their hard-earned money, because it's quite a big investment these days to buy a house. So this RERA has come to safeguard the interest of the buyers and to create a more transparent administration of this real estate transactions. So what happens in this RERA bill is, firstly, there are a few provisions, and in the provisions is that one among them is that the developer has to give a written affidavit that the promoters will promise to have a legal standing to it. Along with all the required documents, the promoter has to give a declaration supported by an affidavit stating that the time of the period within which the project or the specific phase will be completed. The possession date will be very important. It will be very sacrosanct. Further, that the agreement of sale will have to specifically carry on the possession date and the rate of interest in case of the default. And also in the provisions that when you register for RERA, you also should have a clear title of the land. Sometimes the land on which the project is being developed has a lot of litigation disputes and various other matters relating to it. So to safeguard those interests, that before starting off with anything, that they have to get registered with RERA, and they should have those two provisions. Along with that, the land should be free from any encumbrances or any obstruction or any hindrance. Sometimes such land can restrict the promoter's ability to transfer the property. A written affidavit has to be provided by the promoters that the land is free from any obstruction or any encumbrance.
The other provisions of the same act are the real estate builders whose properties, the development area is more than 500 square meters are supposed to be registered with a person called the regulator. The regulator is a government agent who would be responsible for supervising the entire project, and he would also act as the mediator between the buyer and the real estate developer. The buyer can report any sort of grievances or queries with the regulator, and it would be his responsibility to take care of the same. The act also speaks about the abolishment of super built-up area. So basically, super built-up area is the area which includes the common area such as the elevator, the lobby, the stairway, and the other common area that was a part of the apartment building. All these days, the buyers were made to pay for it and in a proportionate amount. And with RERA, now the buyers would be paying only for the carpet area. The carpet area is the area which is between the walls of the house, within the walls of the house rather. They would be paying only for the carpet area. The act also says that with the money collected from the buyers would be put in an escrow account. An escrow account is an account which would be made by the real estate developers, and 70% of the money would go into that account, and the money would be the transactions would be transparent, and the buyers would have all the access to where the money is going to, which would increase transparency in the dealings. Furthermore, the act also says that any non-compliance with any of the provisions of the act would result in 3 years imprisonment and a fine which would go up to like 10% of the project amount.
Okay, RERA is mostly seen as a very consumer-friendly act for many reasons. One is that it offers a better redressal forum for buyers. Each state has to set up a regulatory authority and an appellate tribunal, which will have to dispose of cases relating to in the real estate sector in 60 days. So this will ensure that consumers' complaints and grievances are redressed quickly, efficiently, and also it will be less cumbersome for consumers. Now, all new projects after RERA has been passed will have to be registered under RERA. And this means that all information about the new project, saying, the layout, the timeline, cost, everything has to be uploaded by the developer onto the website. And this ensures that consumer has all the information they need before buying a particular property. RERA will also lead to better utilization of buyers' money. Since the developer has to deposit, the entire amount they collected, the 70% of the amount they collect in an escrow account, which means they can use it only for construction expenses, consumers can be assured that the money that they have paid will not be used for any other purposes except for this. Buyers will also have to pay for the carpet area. Carpet area is the area between the four walls, which excludes all the common areas, as he mentioned, the lobby, lift, etc. Earlier, the consumers used to pay for the super built-up area, but now they pay only for the carpet area. Speaking of long-term, RERA will definitely stabilize prices in the housing sector, because this act will instill a sense of confidence in buyers, which will encourage them to invest in properties. This will also lead to increase in foreign direct investment. As an example, each state can make any kind of change or introduce any clause to RERA. So in Maharashtra, an anti-discriminating clause was introduced, which says that developers cannot, refuse to sell any property to a buyer on the basis of religion, caste, creed. So as you can see, each state can, you know, make it their own and give advantages to the buyers.
So I'll be talking about how RERA is impacting the developer. So as she mentioned, each state can have its own rules and regulations. So what happens here is because each state has different rules and regulations, it causes a lot of confusion among the developers and it causes an upheaval in the market. So what the developers feel is that the law should rather have a proper corrective course of action rather than just penalizing them for various other reasons. Everybody is in the notion that it's usually the developers who delay the projects. But what we don't see is that it's not because of the developers, but it's because of the government. To get a sanction for a project, it takes a lot of time. It takes 12 to 18 months. And it's a very tedious process. And even after the approval to get a completion certificate, again, it takes a lot of time because the government agencies take their own time to give them the completion certificate. Now this again delays the entire project and it's contradicting the whole RERA Act, where it says that the project has to be completed on time. There's also increase in cost for the developers because the sales can only happen post-registration and registration can happen only after approval. So getting the approval again is a problem, and gone are the days where the buyers benefited from the pre-launch offers because they can only now register after approval. So the higher holding cost which the developer is bearing will be passed on to the consumer. RERA also has a rule that in case of any cancellation, the developer has to refund within 60 days. This is very unjustified for the developer because a developer is not a bank with liquidity. So in case if 100 units are sold at due to any reason, if at once 40 of the buyers cancel or delay in payment, this is going to jeopardize the entire project. Because of this, now the developer has to compensate for the other 60 buyers who have made the payment. And this interest which he has to pay for the other 60 members is from his own pocket because he can't use any money from the escrow account because it's being strictly monitored. And because of the whole RERA Act being hyped up, most of the small developers are not able to register because the entire process is expensive. So the smaller developers are being eliminated. This is a disadvantage for the smaller developers, but it becomes an advantage for the bigger developers because they have lesser competition and they can now price their properties according to the competition. So if the competition is decreasing, they're going to increase the price, which will again be transferred to the consumers.
So another sector that was greatly impacted by RERA coming into effect is the real estate broker market. So this came was a huge blow to them. So basically before this, the broker sector was one of the most unorganized sectors of our economy, and they accounted for around 25,600 crore and was about 5 to 9 lakh brokers. So there was no entry or exit barriers whatsoever, and it was almost synonymous to unprofessionalism. So almost everybody was doing a side business as a broker, even a milkman. It was just easy to get a fast buck. So with the advent of RERA, it became mandatory for all brokers to register themselves, and they were given no time frame whatsoever. They had to do it immediately. So now this will weed out the non-serious and the small-time brokers, though it will make it a monopoly, but it'll be easier for the government to exercise control. So for example, in Karnataka, the registration cost is 25,000 rupees for an individual and up to 2 lakhs for a company. And in Maharashtra, it's 10,000 rupees for an individual and 1 lakh for a company. So this will aid in a lot of transparency and accountability, since each broker will get his unique identification number, which will be on the RERA website. So if any buyer wants to verify this broker, he can have a look at the website. And now the brokers will be held liable for any misinformation, and they're only allowed to transact transactions for RERA compliant properties and have to be open with everything. They're also supposed to maintain a lot of paperwork. So now this becomes a huge burden and workload for the brokers, which wasn't there earlier. So a lot of the brokers are now shifting to the already ready and rental sector, because this is will generate faster sales and lesser time and also less complex for them. According to the CREBAI, that's the Confederation of Real Estate Brokers Association of India, by the end of this year, around 50% of the brokers are expected to exit the market, as it's becoming very hard for them to survive.
So even if RERA was brought in for the greater good that would benefit the customers, there are certain pitfalls in this act. Like these downsides are only on the surface level. Since this is a new act and is open for speculation by state governments, people will come up with new ways to take advantage of the loopholes in this act. Certain downsides of RERA are like the rates of construction will go up. This is because there will be a restriction on the use of cash flows by developers because they have to deposit the money in a separate account. Also, there is increase in cost of compliance such as web page maintenance or monthly updation, quarterly filings, etc. There will be pressure to deliver projects on time, and this pressure will be translated to the contractor, who in turn will demand higher rates of construction, and this in turn will lead to an upward pressure on prices for end customer. Also, the past real estate projects are not included in this bill. Only new projects are covered by this bill. So projects that are ongoing or are already completed or are stuck due to clearance or financial issues don't come under this project. Hence, many buyers who have already bought their properties or are halfway through will not be benefited by RERA. Then there will be delay from government agencies. There can be delays caused by government, which sometimes takes a lot of time to clear a project. It is up to the government to set up a strict time frame to approve the project so that the developers can launch, complete, and deliver on time. But the efficiency of government bodies is really unreliable. Also, the registration with the regulator is not compulsory for projects that are less than 500 square meters. So small developers will not be bound to register, and they can escape from the regulation and control of the government. They can take heavy amounts from the lower and middle class people and cheat them and not complete the work on time. Also, they can state false rates to customers, and they can be fooled. The new projects that are launched are expected to be delayed, because the project will not be allowed to launch without the requisite clearances from the government, which generally takes 2 to 3 years. Projects will automatically get delayed. Example, if a promoter is able to build 5 projects in a span of 5 years, now he'll be able to do just 2 or 3. So there will be an adverse effect on the demand and supply gap.
Thank you all of you for your presentation on the topics given to you. Now let's move on for a discussion on all the presented topics, something related and something on the RERA fact. To begin with, I have a question with regards to documentation. Now when we talk about documentation, we also come across a lot of instances with regards to the Karnataka government suddenly taking charge and thinking over lake beds and things like that. And all of a sudden, people who are staying under a roof are put out of their house. So this particular problem could be tackled by the person themselves, and RERA coming in is also come in as a boon. Now, how is this a boon? Let's ask some of you. Any thoughts, people?
On that, there's a provision in the Act which says that the property is required to be free from any encumbrances, which means that when you're going to register your property with the regulator, he's going to go through the history of the property, preferably 30-year check as they call it, and see that if the property is on a lake bed or has any other sort of conversion issues or any other issue, disputes in ownership for that matter, before giving a green signal to the project to go ahead. So I think this way it's going to help the buyers get a clear title and make sure that the money is going into safe place.
Adding to what he said, it's also important to mention that when you register a property or when you register for RERA, like any right now, I just want to start off saying that RERA is here to stay. So now in future, whatever you do with whatever real estate transaction you do is going to start with RERA and is going to also end with RERA. So what RERA, it just makes it easy. It makes it easy for the customer to feel very satisfied that, okay, now when he's investing some amount of his hard-earned money for a property, that's going to be his and it's going to be free from any encumbrance. So for example, if he has to buy that property, in the act, it's free from encumbrance. And then there's also the survey chat which mentions that, okay, those certain approvals you're supposed to take from BBMP Fire and few other approvals. So to know that, okay, that this property has a clear title of land, it has a clear khata, it's not built on any riverbed or any lakebed which is not allowed right now. So only after seeking all those approval from and getting it checked by the architect, engineer and all that stuff, then only the person goes ahead with the transaction of the property and he buys the property. And it's not, it, and buying a property is, it doesn't happen overnight. So it's a long process. So once you do an agreement, you pay a certain amount of money as a booking, and then you register it according to the Registrations Act. And then only after that, then you have a small research, and only after it's free from income, any problem, and all the approvals are there, and if the papers are clean, that's when people buy it. And right now, what's happening in the main scenario is that recently in the recent news is that so many, like just yesterday, the chief minister had, you know, gone for a small visit over the city and he noticed that some property is over a stormwater drain or something. So he ordered them to demolish it. Now, what about those people? Because it's actually, you do not know how to blame it on anyone, but it's because that when they buy it, they didn't know much to go about it, and they've fallen into the ditch.
Okay. Adding on to this, something with regards to the various departments that we often forget to check. Our friends were mentioning something about the documentation and verification with regards to the 30-year clause. And most of the time in city, we also have a problem that we don't have this surveys done, which is actually a department with regards to record keeping of what prevails in which particular place. So that anybody who is buying a property has an appropriate clarity as to what prevailed earlier over there in that particular place, and is it safe for me to continue further. So that's something which is an add-on part that is supposed to be required to be checked. Now, all thanks to this RERA coming in, wherein at least people are getting conscious about their documentation. So it's like better late than never. At least you get to know what your property is like, what your documentation is like, and at least you get that wake-up call. Moving further, there is a mention with regards to inventory management by Mr. Kevin. So here, in and around most of the cities that are coming up, and the Tier 1 cities particularly, we have a new part of the city that's growing, and we have a lot of inventory pile-up. So what's your take on it, Kevin?
I think with demonetization coming into effect, many of the traders with, you know, various projects had a lot of problem keeping up with money. And also at the same time, since they had to, you know, frequent visit banks, get the, you know, deposits done and all. So there was a lot of unsold inventory left with them. And even if they needed to sell it to the other developers, I don't think the developers would have gone and approached them, because at the same time, even the developers were facing a problem with respect to demonetization. So I think this is why, you know, in one part, RERA has come out and I think save the developers and at the same time, you know, the traders. Yeah.
Adding on to what Kevin said, he said about demonetization also helping piling up the inventory for some certain developers. But I would want to say that this demonetization it was actually started off to remove black money from the nation, okay? But over here, in real estate transactions, everything is taken into account. Your PAN card and your various other assets. You need to show your bank statements if you have the capacity to buy that project. So everything is done over here. It's very clean. And because of the liquidity crunch, people were, of course, going after banks. And because they didn't have much money with them, they were actually thinking of renting property than rather buying a property because of the less cash flow they had with them, and that's about it.
Moving on, there was another very important mention about cases and disposal of cases. Now here, this is always felt as a burden when it comes to the civil and session court. And also apart from that, the High Court being one of the highest regulatory body or the executive part as far as our judiciary is concerned. So here, having that as a highest level, at a highest thing at a state level, still we find a lot of cases being piled up over there, and completion of the case or getting appropriate judgment is a matter of concern. So I would like to request Anjani with regards to this particular matter of case pileup.
I think the High Court of every state was, didn't have to handle only real estate, it had many other cases also. But now the RERA has come in and each state has to set up a regulatory authority and an appellate tribunal. And they have to also ensure that the cases are, you know, disposed of in 60 days. And along with the High Court helping them with this, I think this will be really beneficial for buyers, because everyone knows that cases in judicial system drag on for years. And now, hopefully, after the RERA Act tells the state to start, set up a regulatory authority, it will be much faster, less cumbersome for buyers, and this will also lead to greater investment in real estate, because less problems will be faced by the buyers.
Also, on the matter of inventory management, although we see with regards to the market when it comes to the customers or the sellers, it's always been a troublesome fact, because piling up inventory and managing it is always a cost-incurring factor. So with regards to this particular factor, developers was handled by Archana. So let's ask Archana about it.
Okay, so what I feel is the developers, because of RERA, 70% of the money is in the escrow account. So whenever any of the, can I just get the question again? Question again,
it's
repeat.
About inventory management, how has it been a welcome note to developers?
Okay, now here it's actually on a regulatory note. If you try to look at inventory management, it is something which is under a control fact because of RERA coming in. Now, once this control is exercised, although that kind of hush and greed would always prevail, but in spite of that, somewhere having a regulation would always keep a check on oneself. So that basis, if you try to look at RERA coming in, it's actually a welcome note, and most of the builders as such are treating it as a very good thing, very 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 honest and very much a positive thing on that note, that they are not on that competition spirit that they need to push with each other with regards to having their inventories. And accordingly, they need not push themselves also with regards to new projects, because every project that they are trying to come up with, they have a time frame and a procedure. So that will obviously give them that breathing period and comfortably get back with new projects. Now, moving on, something with regards to brokers market that was dealt by Amina. We find that brokers are not only an essential part of new house buying, but also various other parts wherein we have a lot of other areas of real estate transaction. Say, for example, renting a house or taking any kind of place on lease or any other basis. And apart from that, another very important dimension that we have to look in is the new crowd that happens to pour into the cities. And they immediately look for a roof on their head. So they obviously try to go for either hostels or PGs. Hostels, of course, we know that there is a procedure out. What about the other means of transaction as far as brokers are concerned? And how is it going to be dealt with regards to RERA?
So as I had mentioned earlier, now the brokers have a lot of paperwork and things like that. They're a lot more liable. So now when it comes to leasing and rental, it is less more complex. So in a survey that was conducted after RERA, around 42% of them are planning to shift to the rental stream, because that's something where the demand cannot reduce. I mean, if I have to get a rented place, I have to still do it. Maybe people won't invest in land as much for now, at least till it balances out, but rental and lease will continue. So the brokers are trying to tap in on that for now.
Moving further, with regards to the costs or rates that are gonna pile up, with regards to the customers, the reason was pretty much evident that we were supposed to work out with regards to the super built-up area. Right, apart from the corporate area. Earlier, the cost being a part of the customer's price, now it is. It has to be coming in a hidden part or a hidden cost. So let's try to understand as to what are the other costs and related costs that happens to come as a surprise element to the customers.
That was actually the first pitfall of RERA that I had mentioned. The thing is, the rates of construction will go up, and that's what I think is your question, is because there will be a restriction on the use of cash flow that is going to be used for the construction purpose, because the developers have to put in 70% of the cash that they get for the construction into an escrow account, and because of that they have to use it only and only for construction purpose. They cannot use that amount to invest in other properties or something. And after that, there are also increase in cost of compliances, because now everything is online based, and because of which there are monthly updations, quarterly filings, and also web page maintenance. So these costs, the contractor or the developer would not like to bear it upon themselves. So that is why they push it to the end consumers, because ultimately the consumers are the ones who want their house to be built or the construction to happen. So.
Adding to what Anushree said, some people actually forget that just because the developer is charging on basis of the carpet area and not the super built-up area, the prices per square feet will also increase to a large extent. So the lobby you will use, the lift you will use, and the other common areas though you will use. So this comes on the cost of the developer. So what the developer is going to do is, he is going to divide that cost on the basis of your carpet area, and likewise, what you will be charging around 4,300 per square feet, you will almost be paying around 7,400 per square feet. So it's just going to be divided that way, so that the developer, on what he's going to show you in paper, he's going to show you adding that as a hidden cost. And also your clubhouse, your security, your BWSSB, your electricity, your car park, and various other charges will also be added. Like for some developers, they take it as a strategy. Like for example, Prestige Constructions, they don't charge your clubhouse stuff. But developers like Vaishnavi, they take clubhouse separate, they take your legal charges separate, they take your amenities separate, everything is broken down there. But like as you mentioned, the cost, it definitely piles up, but few people are very ignorant about such stuff.
Okay, we now come to an end on the discussions. Now we move on to the open house forum. So if anybody has any questions, kindly raise your hand so that we could proceed accordingly.
Okay, so accepting the fact that there is corruption everywhere, and whatever you have to do, like, for example, even taking a license sometimes or getting certain approvals, the developer has to pay a certain amount of money under the table just to get work done. So what actually happens is that because of corruption, I would say that RERA is more customer-oriented rather than developer-oriented. Where is the developer security? There is no builder security here. So for example, if he has to, you know, get himself registered, he has to get certain approvals and only then he'll get the registration number so that he can advertise that on his advertisements and his marketing campaigns so that people will believe him and people will invest their money on him. So to get that number, to get that registration number, there is no certain time frame mentioned by the RERA authority by how long they're going to give you the thing. Like for example, the builder is liable to pay the customer in case of any delay. But if the registration is delayed, it's just the developers, it's going to be piling up only on the developer. So to get, like for example, now to get the registration number, you have to get certain approvals. Certain agencies will say, okay, fine, this floor is not proper. You've not left certain amount of space for an ambulance to pass. You don't have fire clearance. You don't have water clearance and all sorts of stuff. So to get those things, you have to pay certain money under the table to get that thing done. So all that happens, and that's something which will not stop. RERA will reduce the corruption by the developers, but to get the approvals made, to get certain sanctions, of course, is the developers' activity to get all this done under the table.
Just to answer your question on a straighter note, if I'm not wrong, you were talking about black money or black wealth, to be more specific. Now, when you try to understand this aspect of black wealth, it's all about hiding the records. So it all starts the minute you have a hidden record. Now, one good thing if you try to look at RERA is your project from the scratch is being registered. So the very fact that information is recorded is a catch. So once you have that kind of a catch, all your money that comes in is very clearly under the record. So if it is recorded, it's quite obvious that it will be taxed. So once it is taxed, you are cutting down steeply on a black market as such. So I hope I have answered your question.
To add on to the same thing, the RERA requires the builder to have someone called regulator. So the regulator is basically more like a supervisor who's going to keep a track of everything that you're going to do and make a record of the same. And in case the customers have any grievances or they need to know any sort of information as to where the money is going, they can always get the same through to always get the same information from the regulator. So this way, I think, as Sir said, it's going to create a track of everything that's happened and create a track of where the money has gone. So the question of black money is kind of abolished with this act coming into place.
Yeah, any other questions? Shall we close?
Are there any major builders who are not registered for RERA yet? Any major builders?
To answer your question, on the RERA website, from every state, there are a list of notifications with regards to builders who have not registered. So those parts are being verified and looked into. The names that are very much known and things like that are being put up. Still further, they are working on it with regards to the notifications. So upfront, there is a notification that is there. So who is being registered and who is not. So exactly, yeah. On that note, there would be a certain spaces also, because when you try to figure out everything at one point, catching everybody wouldn't be so easy. So that part is slowly being worked on. July 31st was the last date. So as per that, they are trying to figure out with regards to various constructions that are on but not registered.
like how you asked about certain big developers. So what actually happens is that when they go for approval, there's something called the RERA acknowledgement number and the RERA registration number. So when you go for that, when a developer goes for that, so that means when he gets his acknowledgement number, that means he is actually putting in an effort to get his property registered, but it's not yet registered. So on the website, the developer gets a login ID and a password, and every project on the RERA website has to update the quarterly update, the rundown number and sorts of apartments and plots, the straightforward information that will guarantee the buyer and their project that there's no space of any carelessness. So that's about it.
Also, since each state is, you know, separate and they can add on to whatever, many states actually haven't even set up an authority where, you know, builders can go register. So very few states have set up, and most of them are metropolitan, I mean, you know, states which are already developed. So yeah, it's still in the process basically.
Also, if we see in Karnataka, the rule in Karnataka states that whichever project is 60% complete, they do not have to register under RERA. So they're saying that the government is trying to support all the big builders with like half of their project is complete, like it's almost on the verge of completion, so that they don't fall under this and have to go about the whole the tedious issue of this RERA.
I hope your question is answered. Any other questions? Okay, having this discussion, it was a healthy discussion and a very good platform. Thank you one and all over here. I would like to extend my heartfelt thanks to Father Daniel and Dr. Nirmala Joseph, our Vice Principal and Principal and Vice Principal respectively. And our HOD, Veenu Ma'am, for giving us this opportunity, and all the audience present here. However, to conclude with regards to this particular topic, it's something which has started, and it's always good to have a start instead of just leaving things open and as is, and keep on talking about it on a negative note. So instead of always having this kind of discriminatory talk or any kind of negative talk, it's nice that the government has come up with a regulation and set up a regulatory authority which has at least initiated on certain projects, and working has started. However, as we were discussing, we found that there are certain areas which are still open for corruption, for black wealth creation, and various other means of cheating the customers, or even for that case, getting just work done. So that is something for us to wait and watch as the regulatory body grows further and as the regulation moves on. Thank you, one and all present here.
Now,